Okay, time for convening haven't arrived. Welcome to the 40th day of the General Assembly. Final and last. Chair recognizes the distinguished senator from the 53rd.
Good morning, Mr. President. It's a wonderful day at our state senate. The men and women here are ready for a final day here on day 40. There are a lot of seersucker suits and other light color suits, so that tells you what we're looking forward to. Mr. President, it's been a true honor to serve as the rules chair of this fine body and to serve you, and I wish everybody the best on this last day. The journal's been read and found to be correct.
Thank you, Senator, and thanks for your good work on the journals as well as the Rules Committee as well. Is there objection dispensing with the reading of journal? Reading of journal is dispensed with. Is there objection confirmation of journal? Chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. All senators having bills and resolutions to introduce, don't bring them to the desk. First reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions.
Senate Resolution 555 by Senators Harbison and the 15th and others, a resolution creating Senate Study Committee.
The Veterans Committee.
Senate Resolution 565 by Senator Jeans the 35th and Red the 33rd, a resolution recognizing
natural resources.
Mr. President, that concludes the order.
First readers. Secretary will read standing committees.
Mr. President, the Senate State and Local Government Operations Committee has had our consideration of the following legislation, instructing to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. House Bill 553 do pass, House Bill 562 do pass, House Bill 577 do pass, House Bill 580 do pass, House Bill 601 do pass, House Bill 603 do pass, House Bill 609 do pass, House Bill 612 do pass, House Bill 614 do pass, House Bill 615 do pass, House Bill 621 do pass. Respectfully submit, I, Senator Albers of the 56th. That concludes the order.
It is now time for the morning roll call. Time for the morning roll call. Are there any motions to excuse? Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 36th. She is on Capitol Hill.
36, without objection. Senator from the 36th will be excused. Chair recognizes Senator from the 16th.
If you would ask for unanimous consent for the senator from the 29th, he's en route.
29th, without objection, senator from the 29th will be excused. Any other motions to excuse? Chair recognizes senator from the 3rd.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to excuse the senator from the 29th for business outside of the Capitol.
He just got excused, huh? Senators, please signify your presence by voting the A switch. Secretary will unlock the machine. Let me ask that all senators please take your seats, cease all audible conversation as we are preparing our chamber for our morning devotion. Let me just take a moment to have the Senate also join me in wishing the senator from the 9th and the senator from the 41st a happy birthday today. So, it is now my distinct honor to call upon the senator from the 1st for the purpose of leading us in our pledge and introducing our chaplain of the day. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let's pledge allegiance to the U.S. flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the Georgia flag. Well, good morning to our last day here. Certainly is a pleasure for me to introduce the chaplain of the day, Chaplain Berrios. He comes from my district down in Fort Stewart. He lives in Midway, which is in Liberty County. He's also my district. But let me say first, let me welcome his wife, Carmen, over here to our right. Thank you very much for being here and allowing your husband to be here. Captain Berrios has a very long history in the ministry. He was a missionary evangelist, ministering in 45 countries, and has been in 48 of our states here in the United States. He's been in several places, including Fort Hood, and has been in the Savannah area and Fort Stewart here since last August. I'd like to give him a warm welcome and thank you for Captain Berrios for being here.
Good morning. First of all, I want to extend my thanks to the President of the Senate, Mr. Casey Cagle, for having me here, and also the Senator Ben Watson. As mentioned, my name is Angel Berrios. I'm a chaplain in the United States Army. And you know, as a chaplain in the Army, it's a privilege to serve our country, not only in uniform, but to serve our country as a chaplain. And the Chaplain Corps has been part of the United States Army since the beginning of the Army in 1775. So my mindset, the way I think as a chaplain, or as a minister, or as a human being, is I like to, in my devotional, talk about, as we look at the world, we would all agree that this world has problems. And if we're pessimistic, it's very easy to conclude that there's no solution to the world's problems. But I'm optimistic. I'm a realist and I'm optimistic. I believe that considering the world in which we live in, although we see the wars and atrocities, we see the injustices, as we look around, we see that there is evil, and I'm sure we all will agree on that. All of that sort of paints a hopeless picture of the condition of the world in which we live. But as human beings, we naturally want to fix things. So we see that there is a problem, and the problem, of course, is the condition of the world. Whether our opinion, why the world is in the condition that it is, the opinion is irrelevant. The fact is, it's in a bad condition. So we try to solve these problems. Within ourselves, we find ways to do it, and we do good at certain points, but other times we don't do so well. For instance, one of the first things we want to do to solve our world's problems is education. If we can educate the world, perhaps the world would be a better place. Another way we try to solve the world's problem is money. Try to throw money at the problem. Perhaps that will solve the world's problems. And as the Beatles sang many years ago, love All you need is love. And so we want to perhaps love more, be better people, so that the world would be a better place. Now, none of these man-made solutions is necessarily wrong, but I do believe that the efforts are quite lacking, if you will. And so I would like for us to take a moment to think. As we look at the world in which we live in, we look at the problems. What is the way to solve the world's problems? Now, I don't want to be so, I don't want to be so forward in trying to say that I have the solution, but I will say this, there is a solution. Here's the way I look at it. You see, so many things in life we have no control of, zero control of. We cannot control what happens. The atrocities that take place, God forbid you go to the doctor's office, you get bad news. We can't control a lot of things. So I say this, we have to look outside of ourselves, the human race, and outside of ourselves, and look to God. I am a chaplain. I want to encourage you. I want to challenge you. According to our history, according to statistic today, most Americans have faith in a God of some sort. And that's what I challenge and I encourage you to do. When you do prepare to make decisions here in this chamber, I encourage you to pray to your God. Please understand that within ourselves, we don't have the solution. Please understand within ourselves, we are limited. But there is a God out there who we can turn to, who, by the way, has control of all things. And he can give us the wisdom and the insight and the knowledge on how to solve our world's problems and the solutions that we confront in this chamber. So I encourage you, have faith in God. And I leave you with the quote from Martin Luther King Jr. He said this, "We must have faith that things will work out somehow, that God will make a way for us when there seems to be no way." I'd like to lead in a prayer. Let us stand, please. Let us pray. Our God in heaven, thank you for honoring us with your presence at this time here in this Senate chamber. Show us that without your guidance and blessings, we will not be able to make good and right decisions for the people of the state of Georgia. Our efforts would be futile and worthless, for your word says that through you all things were made, and without you nothing was made that has been made. Therefore, you have all things in control. So indeed, we are convinced that you govern in the affairs of men. Precious Holy Spirit, make yourself real to us by revealing truth about every issue that will be discussed on the floor today. Truth is powerful. Truth is necessary, and truth will bring true liberty of which our state has so long experienced. I rebuke the deceits of darkness that would attempt to derail us from true truth, which is your holy word. I ask these things in confidence, believing that you are here, that you hear us, honor our faith. I ask, in your holy name I pray. Amen.
We would like to introduce the doctor of the day, and to do so, I call upon the distinguished senator from the 42nd.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I'm so honored to introduce our doctor for the day for Sunny Dye. Dr. Kara Martin is an internist and hospitalist with the Southeast Permanente Group and Kaiser Permanente. She has her husband with her today of more than 20 years, Scott Sheeler, and they are the parents of two children. They reside in Decatur, and in her past, she was Miss Georgia 1993 and first runner-up to Miss America 1994, and as in her beauty pageant days, she traveled the state speaking on behalf of the program in the interests of math and science education. So she's obviously brains plus beauty. Please join me in welcoming and thanking our doctor of the day.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be your doctor of the day. And I know it's a very busy day in the legislative session, so I encourage you, while you're busy taking care of the business of our great state, that you take a few moments to take care of yourself. Take care of your own needs, make sure you take your medications, don't skip any meals, stay well hydrated, and of course, if you need anything, we're here for you. I'm happy to serve you and take care of you in the medical office if you need anything. So thank you for your service to our great state today. We appreciate all that you do for us. Thank you.
Let me have the Senate's attention for just a moment, if I might. Let me ask the Senate to come to order. We have a resolution we would like to read, and as many of you know, we have had a former colleague and a wonderful friend, Steen Miles, who served in the body, who has passed away, and we would like to recognize her with a resolution at this time.
Senate Resolution 548 by Senator Jackson of the Second, a resolution honoring Steen Miles and for other purposes. Whereas Steen Miles has long been recognized by the citizens of the state for the vital role that she has played in leadership and her deep personal commitment to the welfare of the citizens of Georgia, and whereas, as a distinguished journalist, Steen began her career in journalism in 1971 as a reporter and anchor for WNDU-TV in South Bend, Indiana, and went on to work for various other news outlets, and whereas Steen is well known for her service as a Georgia State Senator for District 43 and for her remarkable patience and diplomacy and sensitivity to the needs of the citizens of the state, and whereas a woman of deep and abiding faith, she is an associate minister at the Green Forest Community Baptist Church in Decatur, Georgia, and has demonstrated her dedication to teaching the gospel and witnessing Christ through word and deed. And whereas Steen has diligently and conscientiously devoted numerous hours over time, talents, and energy towards the betterment of her community and state, as evidenced by her many leadership positions within the community, and the distinction and numerous awards that she has received for her vision and unyielding commitment to public service, and whereas it is abundantly fitting and proper that the outstanding accomplishments of this remarkable and distinguished individual be further recognized, now therefore be resolved by the Senate that the members of this body honor Steen Miles for her efficient, effective, unselfish, and dedicated public service to the state of Georgia. That concludes the order.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none. The resolution is adopted. I think all of us that were here and had the privilege of serving with Senator Miles always thought of that beautiful smile that she had on her face and the very contagious personality. And she was a wonderful, wonderful individual, and certainly during this time, we will be thinking of her family and having them in our thoughts and in our prayers. And at this time, I would ask that the Senate join me in a moment of silence for former Senator Steen Miles. Let us pray. Amen. Thank you very much. Are there any unanimous consents, senators wishing to rise on a point of personal privilege? Chair recognizes Senator from the 14th District.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. Before we get started with the craziness of the day, I wanted to just take the time to honor an industry and a group of individuals that are near and dear to Bartow County, to Northwest Georgia, to our entire state, to the United States, and to the entire world. And I'd like to read a resolution and then just take a minute to honor them. It says, recognizing and honoring Anheuser-Busch Companies Incorporated for its disaster relief assistance and for other purposes. Whereas since 1993, Anheuser-Busch Companies Incorporated has operated a 900,000 square foot brewery on 1,700 acres in Cartersville, Georgia. And whereas since 1998, Anheuser-Busch Cartersville Brewery has donated and shipped, listen up, donated and shipped 74 million cans of drinking water for disaster relief. And whereas in 2016, Anheuser-Busch donated and shipped well over 2 million cans of water to support communities hit by natural disasters, including the California brush fires, the Louisiana floods, and Hurricane Matthew. And whereas Anheuser-Busch donated over 700,000 cans of drinking water to local wholesalers and the American Red Cross after Hurricane Matthew caused severe flooding and storm surges in parts of southeast United States, including Florida, North Carolina, South Carolina, and here in Georgia. Whereas the Anheuser-Busch Cartersville Brewery donated and shipped over 51,000 cans of storm relief drinking water to Albany, Georgia in January of 2017, which was received by the Albany Beverage Company to be delivered to the Red Cross Relief Center. Whereas it is abundantly fitting and proper that the generous contributions of this compassionate company be appropriately recognized. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Senate and the members of this body, recognize and honor Anheuser-Busch Companies and its Anheuser-Busch Cartersville Brewery for going above and beyond by providing disaster relief assistance to the citizens of this state and this region in their time of need. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to just take a second to let you know right over here, we want to honor, again, our Cartersville Brewery, Anheuser-Busch. Not only do we know of them around the world as providing beer, but they take the time when there is a disaster to stop a line to be able to can water, a basic necessity needed not only in our state, in the United States, but around the world. And many times we hear service above self. Here's a business that puts service above self. When they could continue to sell beer, they could continue to do the things they do, they're stopping their production to donate the resources to those in need. So I would ask you if you would honor them, just letting them know how much we thank them for their service, but also to let them know we're grateful for what they do in our state, for the people here and around the world. Please join me in congratulating them. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Glad to have you all with us today. Thank you very, very much. Chair will now recognize Senator from the 29th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise today on a subject that you might not expect, and that is the senator from the 39th. This will be, I believe, the senator from the 39th's 21st and final session in the Georgia General Assembly. The senator from the 39th and I do not agree on much. We have debated many, many issues during my 7 years of service, most recently late into Tuesday night. But one thing I can say about the senator from the 39th, even though we passionately disagree on a number of policy areas, we've certainly found areas where we do agree. Transparency in government, commitment to a public policy process that is fair. The senator from the 39th, in the way he has participated in debates here on this floor and in committee and in dealing with me privately, he has always treated me, I think, the way that he would like to be treated. And I think there's a lot to be said for someone who can passionately engage on the issues without questioning the integrity of his opponent, without questioning where that person is coming from. He has been a formidable opponent on these issues. If you're going to tangle with the senator from the 39th, you better be prepared. And all I want to say is that I appreciate the voice you have given to a constituency that deserves to be heard. I appreciate your friendship, and I wish you all the very best. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Thank you, Senator. Chair recognizes Senator from the 35th on a point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President. First, I would also like to just give my personal sincere condolences to the family of Steen Miles. We traveled the world together, literally. We went to at least 20 countries together over the years. And I remember when we were in Israel and we traveled, we traced the steps of Jesus Christ and went throughout Bethlehem. And I know that she's a woman of God, and her favorite scripture was, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. So to her family, I have to give just another special condolence. Also, on a different note, today I have enjoyed working with the legislators, even though we have differences of opinions many times. We've had a strong session, and I hope to come back and be able to work again, because no matter what our differences are, like John Lewis said, we all came here on different boats, but we're in the same boat now. So when we sit in this legislature, we do have to make sure that we take care of our community and our people. But today is Green Day under the Capitol. And we, back in 98, I introduced a bill to Zero Waste by 2020, which 39 other states adopted and Georgia didn't. But Georgia did pick up several initiatives off of that bill. And we continue every year to talk about clean air, clean water, recycle, reduce, compost, and moving from green to zero waste. So today we have our organic foods downstairs. We have ice cream, organic ice cream for everyone. And it's in the south wing. So please go and see the green crafts and the eco-friendly products and businesses, et cetera, et cetera. And also for all the legislators in room 216, we have food. And it's all organic, or it's eco-friendly wrappers and everything. So you know, every day, every year, I bring Constituents Day and wear my green. So it's green for thinking clean. Thank you very much, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Chair now recognizes. Thank you, Senator. Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. I rise just to do a little shout out for my two pages. One of them have been here for 5 years now and stays to midnight, but she loves this process. She's on the path to becoming an attorney. And I just wanted to say I am so honored that Jessica has been coming now 5 years, and she will be with us all day paging. And she has a friend, Olivia, who joined us 3 years ago. She's here as well today to serve as a page, and again, they plan to be here to midnight. But I couldn't come to the well without talking about my former seatmate, who also, I know we all had a hand in serving with former State Senator Steen Miles. So my heart is heavy, but I am gonna ask you to pray for my family. We did lose a member on Tuesday, and she's leaving behind three little girls, beautiful little girls, and I just want you all to lift us up in prayer as well. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will.
Chair recognized Senator from the 10th.
Thank you, Mr. President, and members of this body. I rise really with a purpose to do something a little bit different in the well, something that I've not done in my 13 years that I've been here. But I felt this was a good occasion because there's a good friend of all of ours who may not spend any more time with us in this chamber. And he spent 23 years of his life to this body. And I felt it was befitting that we all just kind of take a moment and relive some of the experiences. Mr. President, can I have a little order in the chamber, please? Mr. President, can I have a little order in the chamber, please?
ask the chamber to quieten down. The senator has a point.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, members, because this is really important. We have a member here who spent a lot of his adult years in his body serving this great state, and I personally have learned a lot from him. But I wanted to just take a moment and kind of relive some of the things that the senator from the 39th has taught me, and some of the things that he's taught some of his other colleagues as well. You see, the senator from the 39th has some favorite sayings. And I know he's not gonna get up here and relive those sayings again, so I'm gonna try and do it for him. There's one thing that I remember the senator from the 39th saying from this well of the Senate, and I hope it's something that we all remember, but he had a way of reminding us anytime that he was kicked off of committee that he was always going to start his own committee, because he was going to start an ad hoc committee of one. I also remember a time when the senator from the 39th has a propensity for always appearing on TV. And there was one time up here where he was accused of owning his own TV station. My good friend from the 39th likes reminding us all the time that he is indeed a professor. And if you remember, he had a way of using words up here in this well that none of us really understood what he meant, but we all just kind of accepted it because it was true, what we call Vincentisms. And I certainly hope that he reminds us of some of those Vincentisms, and I'm hoping that he's gonna write them down so I can carry them with us. And the senator from the 39th was certainly willing to work on both sides of the aisle. As a matter of fact, he was always proud of himself for being bipartisan. And bipartisan to the senator from the 39th was usually himself and just one of his other colleagues from outside on the ropes. It didn't have anything to do with the other party. There was a time when this senator mentioned he was aspiring to higher office. And as many fights and arguments that he had with members from the other party, he was always gracious enough to remind the other party that he indeed was running for a higher office, and he reminded all of you, by the way, with, oh, by the way, I expect you to contribute to my campaign. But there's one other thing that I remember this senator, and it speaks to his tenacity and how he was always, always committed to this body. There's a story that he does not tell very often. I understand the senator from the 39th was putting up yard signs at one time. Now, you gotta be really tough and dogged to put up yard signs and to win as many elections as he did, but there was a time when somebody actually pulled a gun on the senator from the 39th. He was putting up yard signs and somebody pulled a gun on him. So what does he do? Well, it's my understanding that he started arguing with the guy. The guy really didn't understand what he was saying, and he got so confused he ran off and left Vincent there putting up his yard signs, the senator from the 39th. But his favorite Vincentism that I really, really like was when, and it's not something that I would really say from this well, but he had a way of saying things, being a civil rights activist, being a great professor that he is, being a great legislator and a great senator. He would often remind us that he had the ability to turn this whole state of Georgia into a plantation. So, Senator, I just wanted to say on behalf of your colleagues here that those things that you share with us will always be remembered. The way that you fought for those things that you believed in certainly was new and true and dear to my heart. And the 13 years I spent with you really has been a learning experience. You taught me how to stand up and fight for what I thought was right. And I'm sure all of your other colleagues and as well share the same sentiment. So congratulations on your future. On your future plans, we stand with you, and we look forward to continue to work with you in some capacity or other in public service. Thank you, Senator, for all you've done, not just for this body, for this great state, and God bless you with your future endeavors. And Godspeed.
Absolutely. Thank you, Senator. Chair now recognizes the Senator from the 39th. Chair recognizes Senator from the ninth. State's inquiry.
Isn't it true that if the senator from the 39th makes good on all his promises from his Republican colleagues to make contributions to his future political endeavors, he'll start with a nice balance in his campaign account?
He's going to do that later. Chair recognizes him 39th.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I am almost speechless. I said almost. But it is a bittersweet day that I rise on this occasion, but I am keeping in mind one of the icons that I met 22 years ago when I first began running for public office. Old man Simpson, James Simpson. I've come to this well before and talked about Mr. Simpson. He was the president of the John O. Childs Senior High Rise. For those of you who don't have high-rise senior residences in your district, in the city of Atlanta, a senior citizen high-rise is a very important location because people who live there always vote. So I went humbled to see Mr. Simpson, old man James Simpson. And Mr. Simpson told me, Senator Fort, well, I wasn't senator then, he said, Fort, he said, if you get elected, don't go down there being quiet. Don't go down there forgetting who sent you down there. Don't go up under that gold dome and forget where you come from. And I have endeavored, every time I come on this floor, and I push that red or green button, I tell you, Mr. Simpson's admonition is with me. So it is a bittersweet day. Mr. Simpson has gone on to glory, but his admonition rings in my ears still. First of all, I want to thank the voters of the 39th District for sending me down here 11 times. It is the highest honor of my public life to have represented one of the most diverse districts in the state. And it has been a great ride these last 21 years. I want to recognize my two of my children who are in the chamber, Zan Fort and Zoe Fort. Raise your hands. You will be seeing more of them sooner than later. But I've had a great ride. I've enjoyed myself greatly. I've partnered with many of you to do some important things to impact the state. We worked together, many of us, to take the Confederate emblem off the state flag. And I know better now than I did then how important that was to create a symbol that unified the state as opposed to separated it. I was here and worked with some of you to pass the nation's toughest predatory lending law that was recognized nationally as something that could have lessened the 2008 financial crisis. Probably the proudest thing that I've done is help to get funding for two schools in the city of Atlanta, Atlanta Technical College and Atlanta Metropolitan College. Young people go there who depend on those colleges in a way that other schools cannot provide. We helped to create the first DBE program in the state for DOT work, funded by the new gasoline tax. We've had a great ride. There have been some bitter moments. I experienced one of them just yesterday when the bill that y'all supported, a bill to create an inspector general at City Hall, did not get the requisite signatures on the House side to become law. That's unfortunate because I believe City Hall has lost its way. Three criminal investigations going on. I expected more of my colleagues in the House, but that's okay. The struggle will continue on that. But I want to tell you that the best moments that we have as legislators here in the Senate is when we remember the regular folk that sent us down here, the regular folk that don't have lobbyists, the regular folk that don't have lawyers with their Armani suits and their alligator shoes and their crocodile briefcases. When we remember the 99%, we are at our best. So I hope that my tenure has been one that has at times reminded my colleagues of that, that has refocused us on those who need our attention, the regular people who are doing their best to provide for themselves and their families, of people who are trying to stay in the middle class, and those who are striving to join it. So it's been a great experience these last 21 years. The friendships that I have created, and you'd be surprised, I think people outside of this chamber would be surprised at how many friendships that we create here. Even people we disagree with, we can still be friends. The Georgia State Senate is special. It is a different place, but I will be back. I have a little bit of business to take care of in the next 7 months, but I'll be back to be with you at some time in the future. But thank you for your friendship. God bless you, and God bless the state of Georgia. Thank you.
Secretary will read a resolution. No, we don't have it yet. Well, we do have a resolution for the senator from the 39th that we will read a little later and adopt. Let me just personally say to the senator from the 39th, you will be missed, and your contribution is greatly appreciated on behalf of not just your constituents, but also the great state. It's a pleasure to call you a colleague and a friend. Secretary will read a resolution.
Senate Resolution 571 by Senator Tate of the 38th, a resolution recognizing and commending the Honorable Vincent Fort and others, and for other purposes. Whereas Vincent D. Fort is the Senator for District 39 in the Georgia Legislature, where he has represented parts of Atlanta, East Point, College Park, Union City, and South Fulton County since first winning election to the State Senate in 1996, and whereas he received his bachelor's degree from Central Connecticut State University and his master's degree in African American History from Atlanta University, and whereas Senator Fort is a career educator, working most of his teaching career at the schools of historically black colleges and universities, including the Atlanta University Center, Morris Brown College, and Morehouse College. And whereas as a professional educator, he supports public schools and teachers and is a selfless advocate and champion for the preservation of public schools, equal access and opportunity for all students, and the improvement of public school systems and programs which include families, neighborhoods, and extended community involvement. And whereas he has successfully led efforts to secure tens of millions of dollars in additional funding for Atlanta Metropolitan College and Atlanta Technical College in order to provide affordable educational opportunities for Atlanta's young adults and those wishing to pursue a continuing education education and training. Whereas he served as president of the Atlanta Planning Advisory Board, where he worked successfully with city leaders to improve Atlanta's neighborhoods, including a partnership with the labor movement to provide job training in the neighborhoods near Atlanta's 1996 Olympic Stadium. And whereas Senator Fort led the fight with Governor Roy Barnes to pass the nation's toughest law against predatory lenders, and whereas his legislation to fight predatory lending has been recognized by the national media as a model that could have helped reduce the severity of the 2008 financial crisis, and whereas Senator Fort was the first Georgia legislator to sponsor a bill to create a state hate crimes law, an effort he continues to lead to this day, which would enhance penalties for criminals who choose their victims based on biases of race, gender, religion, or sexual orientation, and whereas Senator Fort has served with distinction as the minority whip of the Georgia Senate, the second highest ranking position in the Democratic caucus, where Senator Fort has been the Georgia Senate's leading fighter for progressive values for more than two decades, and whereas he is a passionate believer that every person should live in a just and fair society, committing his life's work to this cause, and whereas he is the proud father of one son, Zan, two daughters, Zoe and Faith, and two beautiful granddaughters, Giselle and Chloe, where Senator Fort has provided fearless leadership for the Senate Democratic Caucus, and his day-to-day presence will be remembered and can never be replaced, whereas it is abundantly fitting and proper that the outstanding accomplishments of this remarkable and distinguished Georgian should be appropriately recognized. Now, therefore, be resolved by the Senate that the members of this body recognize and commend the Honorable Vincent D. Fort for his dedicated service, mentorship, and leadership. That concludes the order.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none. The resolution is adopted. Congratulations again, Senator. I have your resolution here. Chair will recognize Senator from the 13th.
Thank you, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I come today to recognize Ms. Renita Hurd, who is retiring from the Department of Human Services. She's here with her family from Leesburg, Georgia. She began her career 30 years ago. She's a graduate of Fort Valley State. She began as an accounting tech with Child Support Recovery Services, and she worked her way through the ranks of the division, serving as an assistant regional manager, a district and field operations, and eventually becoming the division's director in 2012. Ms. Hurd also is deputy commissioner of the Department of Human Services in 2013, overseeing the administration of the department's three divisions, which together employ 9,000 Georgians and serve 1.8 million people in the state of Georgia. Back in the 90s, my company contracted with Department of Family and Children's Services, so our paths actually crossed. There was no way she knew that I'd be presenting her with this award all these years later, and there was no way I knew that either at the time. But I thank you for your service, your dedication. Would you please stand and be recognized by the body? Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Thank you, Senator. Senator from the 15th, are you wishing to be? Chair's recognized, Senator from the 15th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I too wanted to get up and say a few words about the Senator from the 39th and my service with him. I believe myself and the Senator from the 4th served with him the longest in this body, so I just wanted to make sure that I got up and said a few good words about our Vincent Fort. A lot of us may or may not know the great story about his legacy, his history. We have talked over the years about his family from Alabama, Hertzboro, Alabama, and the circumstances in which they left Alabama. I think they left in a hurry because they had to. I think he put it as they were ran out of Alabama, and he'd been fighting to get back ever since. So that's why he has that fighting nature. In addition to that, myself and Congressman Scott attended his wedding. And Congressman Scott and I were discussing the fact that and how we were wondering how he got that beautiful bride that was at his side at his wedding, and we had fun with that. So one of his great admirers he didn't mention was that he also admired Maynard Jackson, and a lot of times you'll see him with one hand in his pocket emulating Maynard because he had such great respect for him. And finally, one of the things that I notice about the senator from the 39th, that every time he got to the well, he always looked up. He always looked up at the gallery and the ceiling, and you always wondered what he was doing. So I just wanted to say to him, I want him to keep looking up and speaking up and representing the people of the state of Georgia. Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 26th on a point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President, and ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I too will miss my good friend from the 39th. We have been in many discussions. Sometimes behind closed doors, we might have came to fisticuffs because we vehemently disagreed with one another. But again, I want to thank him. In my latter years, I've learned to not let my temper get the best of me, and as they always said, even back in the day, let's try to work it out. But now on a serious note, behind that, I want y'all to understand me and understand me well. We've talked about Obamacare, but I want to talk about GHC, Georgia Healthcare. You know, longevity, everybody wants to live a long life. I happen to be a diabetic, and every day, I have to use this to get my blood sugar level down. Express Scripts said I need to take Humalog. This is Novolog. I had to get a prescription when we had United Healthcare. I took Humalog, and in a week, my A1C went from 7 to 12, and I couldn't get my blood sugar down under 185 and took 73 units one day. And so I went back to my doctor, and he said, David, some drugs work for some folks and some don't. When I went to get my refill Saturday, they told me $247 for this medicine. Now it went from 80 to 115 and now 247. Now, I know who to call, know who to talk to. Don't know whether we got it worked out or not, but the senator from the 45th had all of them in the hall. It is ridiculous. We ought to take back our health insurance. When we ran it, we ran a good program. We took the rebates and applied them to the entire program to try to reduce our costs for our state employees. And what I'm saying to you now, CEOs are determining what medicine you take. Not the doctor, but Express Script is determining what medicine you take. Now, I'm fortunate, if I got to pay the $247, I can pay it. But what about these state employees where they change their medication and there's nothing they can do? They call the folks and they tell them we're sorry because of the formulary. It is a shame that we allow Georgia employees and retirees to have to go through that. We need to take our insurance back over and not be blackmailed. Everybody gets mad. We can go to Canada. I can go to Canada and get this for about $60. But yet they put these blockades on where you can't go to Canada and get your medicine. The same pharmacists not the pharmacist, but the same folks and drug makers make the same product that goes into Canada.
Time has expired, Senator.
Mr. President, I appreciate the time, but I would ask you, we need to take our insurance back over.
Thank you, Senator. Chair, we recognize Senator from the 36th will be our last point of personal privilege for the day.
Thank you, Mr. President. Colleagues, I rise briefly to, briefly to sound the praises of our colleague that is departing today, the Senator from the 39th, recognizing his last day in service here at the state. Now, I will say to you, I knew this young man before he ever became a senator. I knew him as a professor. I knew him as a professor who helped, who united with his students to protest. I know you'll find this hard to believe, to protest wrongdoing, righting wrongs on the college campus, and encouraging student activism as a professor. I knew him when he engaged in a vitally important issue, that being landfills, placement of landfills, inappropriate placement of landfills, that Senator Scott, now Congressman Scott, worked so hard on. I knew him when he staffed a city council person, but was a staunch fighter in any role that he found himself in. That is who he is. That is his essence. He's not going to be silenced. He's going to stand up and speak out, and we've all seen that here in this chamber. So I think without dwelling on it too long, Senator, the Senator from the 39th may be the colleague that I've worked the longest with, because we were in the trenches on the landfill bill. Senator Scott got 56 senators to sign that bill and then came and worked on the House. And Senator Fort, as I say, Senator soon to be Fort, was there in the trenches night and day. So I knew his stalwart spirit and his commitment to stand up, his commitment to activism, his belief that ordinary people can change history, and his willingness to put aside many other personal considerations and make many sacrifices to work night and day to uphold his values and to make our democracy a fuller democracy. He has stood countless times again and again for those values, and it's been an honor and a privilege to work with Senator Fort. I actually, as he's entered in this race for mayor, I'm still mourning what it's going to be like to be here in the Senate without his leadership, without his strong, unyielding voice. Now, you know, Senator Fort really practices that old maxim of no permanent enemies and no permanent friends. Y'all remember, 1 year ago on the 40th day, he took me on a local bill and snatched it off the consent calendar. Yes, and we had to go down to the wire toe to toe. I have never really rubbed it in that I prevailed on the floor on that vote, but this might be a good time to mention that. But I bring it to you in the spirit that he will stand up for what he believes and put personal considerations aside, and he'll stand up to a very dear friend, a steadfast colleague who's been with him in the trenches over and over, if he believes in the cause that he's fighting, and that is laudable, and can get on your nerves when you're on the other end of that, but then the next time he'll be with you when he stands and fights alongside you for shared values. Senator, we will miss you immeasurably. We have been privileged to share constituents together, and I will say that Senator Fort always reminds me of which constituents got moved over to me in the last reapportionment lines moved. And I've taken whole small cities from him, in fact. Not my doing, but the doing of the map writers.
Time has expired.
I will take my seat, but simply could not keep my seat without rising to salute and applaud the honorable service of Senator Fort and wish him the very best as he moves forward in this arduous campaign. Thank you, Senator Fort. It means more than I can say to have served with you.
Thank you, Senator. You have a consent calendar of privilege resolutions that are before you. Is there objection? Without objection, the consent calendar of privilege resolutions are therefore adopted. We have additional resolutions we would like to read and adopt at this time. Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 551 by Senator Miller of the 49th and others, a resolution committing congratulating Fred, young Fred Kitchens, on the occasion of his retirement and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chair is none. The resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 562 by Senator James of the 35th, a resolution committing the Afa-Ukwa Association Incorporated and recognized May 27, 2017 as Afa-Ukwa Association Day and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 563 by Senator James the 35th and others, a resolution recognizing commending the Akwa Ibom State Association of Nigeria Incorporated and for other purposes.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none, the resolution is adopted.
Senate Resolution 569 by Senator Miller of the 49th and others, a resolution honoring and commending the life of Arnold Melvin Wright and his outstanding contributions as a husband, a father, a United States Army soldier, and a sheet metal journeyman and for other purposes. That concludes the order.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chair is none. The resolution is adopted. Are there any motions to withdraw or commit? We have a local consent calendar. Are there any objections filed on any of the bills on the local consent calendar?
Mr. President, there are no objections filed.
Is there objection to agreeing to port a committee on the state and local governmental operations, which is fair, will pass the bill? Chair is none. Port a committee is agreed to. All those in favor of the local consent calendar will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. On the local consent calendar, the yeas are 47 and the nays are 2, and the bills on the local consent calendar are therefore adopted. Let me have the Senate's attention. We are ready to begin conducting some of our business, and Chair will first recognize the Majority Leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to bring a point of order as I've been reviewing our notebooks today and looking at the different bills and agrees and disagrees that we have. I would like to raise the issue of germaneness on Senate Bill 3, one of our top priorities. As I have reviewed the bill as it's come back from the House, I have a complaint that it is non-germane amendments been attached, and I'd like to speak to that, please.
Senator has moved, and Secretary will read the caption.
Senate Bill 3 by Senator Tippins of the 37th and others, a bill be titled Enactment in Chapter 2 of Title 20 of the CGA relating to elementary and secondary education so as to enact the Creating Opportunities Needed Now to Expand Credential Training Act. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 46th to speak to his motion.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, if you could give me your attention for just a little bit this morning. One of the flaws in our system is on this last day, we are asked to vote on literally dozens, sometimes over 100 different bills. You have on your desk this morning a notebook that's 3 inches thick with dozens, maybe even 100 different bills that we have already passed and sent to the House, and they have come back to us. Many of them have changed, sometimes significantly. I'm a detailed person. I pride myself on reading every bill before I vote on it. But you better be a speed reader if you're going to read these bills today before we vote on them. I think the Georgia Constitution requires that we have a single subject matter within a bill. There's a reason for that. The reason is that you are sometimes given a Hobbesian choice. You may have to vote for something you disagree with in order to vote for a bill that you do agree with when they're combined. It's a very clever tactic. We see it happen more than it should in this body. The way we prevent that from happening and putting us in a position to vote on multiple subject matters in one bill is by ruling different subject matters non-germane to the original bill. Well, let me tell you, the games have begun. If you pay attention to some of these bills, you're going to see that completely unrelated subject matters have been attached. Well, lo and behold, it just turns out, as I opened the book this morning, the first bill was a House substitute to Senate Bill 3. You will remember those first six bills were Senate priorities. Senate Bill 1 dealt with protecting Georgia from domestic terrorism, one of the primary functions of government. To protect us from a known threat, we passed a bill out of here with bipartisan support. I remember vividly the senator from the 2nd and the 22nd engaging with me, amending that bill to make sure that it protected the rights of all Georgians to exercise free speech and to protest any government action that they disagreed with. But it also protected the safety of Georgians and the safety of our infrastructure, our power grid, our water systems, our highways, our port, our airport. That bill did not even pass the House. Our top priority was voted down the other night, and in a version that had been perfected by the House Judiciary Committee non-civil, I think it came out with only two no votes after 8 hours of hearing and amendments. Very disappointing, but this is a 40-day session, and the 40th day is just beginning. I have hope that our friends in the House will reconsider that and find a way to look after Georgians. Senate Bill 2 deals with protecting small businesses from unduly burdensome regulations. We are so proud that we are the number one state in the country for doing business, and that has been giving tremendous benefits to our citizens as new industries come here with new jobs, so our citizens can take care of themselves and their families by giving an honest day's labor for an honest day's work. That bill is still just sort of marinating in the House as the 40th day wears on, and I am hopeful and have been given some optimism this morning from talking to their leadership that it may see a vote in time to get over here for us to work on that today. Leads me here to Senate Bill 3. This is the Connect Act. All the bill does is help a high school student receive credit towards industry certification for the skilled trade so they will be job ready when they get out of high school, ready to go to work and earn a living. Businesses will come here if they know when we graduate high school students they are job ready. This bill was vetted through our education committee. I think it passed here unanimously or close to it. Bipartisan support for this. It's good for all Georgians to help our folks get good jobs. Now it goes over to the House, and lo and behold, I'm reading the bill this morning, and there's an entire new section that's been added. If you pull it out of you, it's the first one on this gigantic notebook. Go back to page 15. Now suddenly, you gotta remember the bill was in Title 20. Education is the subject matter of our bill. You have a whole new section that's in Title 40 that deals with motor vehicles and traffic. And it allows for speed cameras. We already got red light cameras we have to deal with where you really can't even tell who's driving your vehicle. You may be getting a ticket, but they call it a civil fine. If somebody borrows your car, one of your children drives your car, your wife or husband drives your car through a red light, they get this fine. Many of us have fought to make that a fair system over the years. Well, this lets them have a speed camera that can give you a speeding citation. Has nothing to do with the accreditation of kids coming out of high school to be job ready. So I'm asking the chair, president of the Senate, to rule from lines 496 on in this bill non-germane because it has nothing to do with the original bill. And I'm gonna start keeping my eyes as fast as I can read on these stacks to see how much other chicanery goes on in the House as they tack unrelated items on our bills. And I'm asking, I'm imploring the House, stop the gamesmanship, look at the bills on the subject matters that we're presenting, either agree to them or disagree to them. If you can perfect them through an amendment that is relevant to the subject matter, bring it on. We will always accept our friends in the House that may have helpful suggestions to perfect these bills. But on this bill, Mr. President, I'm going to ask that you rule Part 3, Section 3.1, on to the end of this bill, non-germane, and let's take up the subject matter that we sent to be dealt with by the House. Mr. President, I'm happy to answer any questions, or I'm glad to yield the will, and I ask everybody to support the sanctity of this process and the dignity of our Senate and our deliberative process by ruling this non-germane.
You have a question from the Senator from the 41st.
Senator, yield.
Be glad to, Mr.
Is
Leader.
Is it not true that in all your years in the Senate, this is about the worst that it has ever been as far as the House putting changes to bills that were not germane or different subject matter?
Never seen anything like it, Mr. Leader. I, of course, am personally invested by carrying Senate Bill 1, the anti-terrorism bill, and this same provision of speed cameras at one point got attached to that bill in the Rules Committee, I believe, came out. I don't know if it got taken out or not. That may be part of why that bill failed, because it had a totally unrelated matter that many people feel is unconstitutional infringement of our rights put in the bill.
And is it not further true that the minority party supports effort to try to make sure bills follow our rules and are germane, and also is counting on your leadership and making sure that happens, whether it be a member's bill who's in the majority or minority party?
Absolutely, Mr. Leader, and I very much treasure our relationship as we've worked in tandem this year, and we'll continue that relationship with you. If you see things, and you're about to see one, because I'm going to have another motion in a minute where a bill supported by a minority member is also being hijacked, as we may call it, or had other things that are riding along with the underlying bill that you think are non-germane, let me know, and I'll do the same with you, and I think we'll have a splendid day working in a bipartisan fashion to move the bills that have gone through the process, through the committees, through this body, and have been fully vetted as we go forward. And I appreciate your help on that, Mr. Leader.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 31st for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Does the majority leader yield?
I yield.
I've looked at this bill as well, and I think I agree with you on the claims that you've made. And if we're right about the germaneness of this, is it not true that the House has acted in a manner that would be deemed unconstitutional?
I believe you're accurate in that, Senator, and I think that both portions of the bill could fail if challenged in court because they do not comply with a single subject matter requirement of the Georgia Constitution. So going along with these things subjects these bills to challenge in court. A wise, studious lawyer that looks back, you remember the old Brown books we used to have that had the actual bill that passed rather than just the changes to the code section that we see? You can challenge a bill on those basis in court. And so I think when we go forward with these multi-subject matter bills that are not related, sometimes they can be in a different title and be related, but generally speaking, they should be within the same title of the Georgia Code. I think you jeopardize both portions.
Do you yield for another question?
I'll be happy to yield to you, Senator.
Senator, you may not be privy to this information, but I know that the members of this body took an oath on the first day of the session where they raised their right hand and placed their left hand on a Bible and swore to uphold the Constitution of the state of Georgia and of the United States.
Senator, I'm privy to it. I took the same oath. I was here.
Do you believe that the House took that same oath?
I know that they did. It's required by law.
So what you're saying is that they have violated their oath of office by voting to do something unconstitutional.
I think you're making a very good point. Of course, I'm not calling out anybody by name because I don't know who voted for or against it or who proposed the amendment. And we all have this zeal and this passion for our different issues. So I'm not throwing stones, but I'm asking us all to let's follow the rules because it comes up with better legislation for the people of Georgia.
Senator, do you think that it is ignorance on their part or just a blatant violation of the Constitution?
Now, Senator, let's don't get to that. We're going to need their help on some bills here in a little while. So I'm sure they're very wise, and hopefully they'll heed our advice here if the president sees this the way I do as a non-germane matter.
Chair recognizes Senator in the 45th for a question.
Mr. Leader, would you please yield?
I'd be happy to yield to the chairman of the Health Committee.
Mr. Leader, isn't it true for the first time ever that we literally have to have Excel spreadsheets? Because we cannot tell what bill is coming forward without referencing that spreadsheet. Is that not true?
Senator, you are so accurate that it's scary, some of the complications of some of these bills.
Senator, would you further yield?
I'd be happy to, Senator.
Is it not true that health care and mental health issues have been in the forefront ever since we've had a new presidency, and that new wind is coming? And changes are coming, but here in the state Senate and in the House of Representatives, those changes are not occurring. Is that not true?
Senator, I know that you have such a passion and knowledge for what you speak that I would defer to you on that. I will say I think that all of us share the zeal that providing for the safety and security of our citizens, the health of our citizens, and the education of our citizens are the core issues for which we're here and why we need government.
Would you further yield for one last question?
I'd be happy to yield, Senator.
Is it not true that one of the bills that you're talking about, Senate Bill 104, from a senator that I've worked with for years and years and years, bipartisan on the issue of child sex trafficking and human trafficking, that Senate Resolution 307, a joint resolution, has not even made it out of the Rules Committee, and that issue is very important to a lot of people in this room? Is that not true?
Absolutely, Senator, and amen to that. I will be back to speak on Senate Bill 104 shortly. And as I look through the notebook, I noticed your work this session that you're focused on Senate Bill 4 has also run into some problems, and I'm going to invite you to please help speak to that, and let's try to address this issue on that bill as well, because I know you understand the issue better than anybody in the room and have more passion for it than any other senator. I hope you'll
help guide us in that process.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the will, and I ask Mr. President to rule that section of the bill non-germane before we take it up for business.
I think the majority leader has been very, very clear on what the underlying bill does and the importance of it relative to workforce development. And the amendment by which the House placed on it has absolutely no relationship with the underlying bill. Therefore, it will be ruled non-germane. It will go back to the House with a note letting them know that the amendment has been ruled non-germane. Chair recognizes the majority leader again.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm much appreciative of that ruling. I'm sure this body is. I would make another motion adds to germaneness that would deal with Senate Bill 104 that was just mentioned in that debate. There's a portion of that that in my view is non-germane, and it's a big portion of it, if I could be heard on that as well.
You are recognized. Read the caption. Read the caption.
Senate Bill 104 by Senator James the 35th and others, a bill be titled an act amending Article 3, Chapter 5, Title 16 of the OCGA, relating to kidnapping, false imprisonment, and related offenses, so as to require the posting of the human trafficking hotline model notice in government buildings and for other purposes. That concludes the order.
Chair recognizes the majority leader to speak to his motion.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm back. And I hope this isn't repeated all day long as I sort through these bills as they come forward. Good Senator from the 45th pointed out that a minority party bill, Senate Bill 104, has been hijacked once again by the House, completely sending back a non-germane version. If you were to have looked at the original bill, Senate Bill 104, which we passed, the Senator from the 35th sponsored with great passion. I think she had a unanimous vote on this bill, a bipartisan vote from this body. It was simple. It created a model to post a hotline number for victims of sex trafficking. The passion of the Senator from the 45th, the Senator from the 35th, and many of the rest of us in this body to try to stop this travesty of sex trafficking. And you can review the bill, and here's one of the problems with the notebooks, is you don't necessarily see the underlying bill that passed the Senate. Unless you're very organized, you see the version that comes back. Our version that the good Senator from the 35th filed dealt with Title 16, and it dealt with the crime of sex trafficking and posting notices to help post the identification of a hotline for victims of sex trafficking. Now, I don't know whether this is just some type of trick or joke they're playing on her or this body, but the House has stripped that language out entirely. You won't find a mention of that when you look through the pink version that came over from the House. They have amended the bill by completely deleting the subject matter of it and enclosing instead a bill that is House Bill 9 that dealt with upskirting. I'm sure you're insulted by that, Senator from the 35th, because it has nothing to do with the underlying bill. And we've already passed Senate Bill 45. That the Senator from the 20th has worked diligently on before the session even began. We passed it out of this body. It went and passed the Judiciary Committee in the House and got in their Rules Committee. So all they had to do is put it on the floor and vote it out if that's the bill they wanted. Instead, they have insulted the Senator from the 35th. I guess it's some battle of who gets pride of authorship of the upskirting bill or whatever, but it has nothing to do with the bill that we sent. Usually you can, move to strike a portion of the bill that's non-germane and let the underlying portion go forward, but that's kind of tricky in this case because they have deleted the underlying bill, as far as I can tell, reading them this morning as I came in to review them. So, Mr. President, I don't know the proper procedural move other than to say that this bill that's in our notebooks is non-germane to Senate Bill 104 unless there's some portion of it that can be saved. I would leave that to the chair's discretion. And while I'm here, you know, I loved the comments from the senator from the 39th, my good friend. And I hope the public realizes that even though some of us have a hat that says Republican on it and some has a hat that says Democratic, that we're all working for the state of Georgia, and we have agreement on about 90% of the issues. This was one of those bills. And so as the majority leader, I'm here working with my minority leader and the minority whip and the senator from the 35th and the senator from the 20th to let's follow the rules and let's get the business done. Let's stop the gamesmanship. Let's deal with the bills that come to us and vote them out on the single issues that they address. Mr. President, I'll be happy to take questions on this, or I'll yield the well, and I ask for that germaneness ruling.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 41st, Minority Leader.
Sir, yield.
I yield.
Distinguished Leader, is it not true that we have your assurance that once these matters are rectified, that you'll do all you can at meeting with the House later to make sure the underlying bill from the Senator from the 35th gets
you
a fair hearing and has every opportunity to proceed?
You betcha. And those meetings go on all day. There's a lot of times where you'll see us taking breaks in here, and the public probably wonders, why are they gone? This is the last day. Well, a lot of those meetings are occurring during our breaks, and I'll be doing that. And sometimes you can find an appropriate vehicle, a related subject matter bill that this could be attached to or amended to, and we'll be trying to do that within the rules, and we're certainly going to try to get any bill that passed this body out of the House and back to us in a form that is constitutional so that we can get on with the business of the people of Georgia. Thank you.
No further questions.
Thank you, Mr. President. I yield the well.
Senator from the 26th, you wish to be recognized. You're recognized.
You know, I've seen this over and over. You know, you serve here 42 years, you see the games that are being played between the House and the Senate, because I used to do them. I used to be on the House side then. Mr. President, I would like for us to take up the agrees and the disagrees before we deal with any bill that we table, so that if we are going to do something, the conference committees can go to work to try to resolve the differences between the Senate and the House. We ought to try to do that rather than take up all these bills. I mean, we were here the other night, and the senator from the 46th came down and said, look, they just killed a bill without anything. We adjourn. So rather than, you know, we talk about it, we can play the game too. Now, I would assume that everybody over here has got some common sense. Don't have to have a college degree, but just some common sense. So I would say to all of you, rather than take up the table bills we have on the calendar, that we go through the agrees and disagrees and allow the president to appoint the conference committees, and then we go back to work on the bills that we table. I think that would help us in doing a lot of things, and as the senator from the 46th talked about. So, Mr. President, I'd like to be recognized when I go back to my seat for a motion. Are there any questions?
No questions.
I thought I was pretty clear.